I am very happy to reach the final presentation in the series of renal transplantation update about the medical and surgical complications after kidney transplantation. So the corners will include infections, malignancy, diabetes, bone and metabolism, urology perspectives, and concluding remark. Let us start with the infection. This is a very nice data from Transplant Infectious Diseases, a review of the scientific registry of transplant recipients, published data June 2017, because it shows, as you see in this table, the donor recipient site of megalovirus serology pairs in the kidney as a deceased donor or live donor, and you can find here the recipient serology either negative and positive in this period of time, and the evolution by from 2010 to 2014. So you can look at the recipient negative and donor negative or positive, recipient positive and donor negative or positive. The most important risk in the CMV is the presence of donor positive and recipient negative. So this is the cocktail of the highest risk in the transplantation. And this is for the adult, and this is for the pediatric, and this is solid organ transplantation. Another important point showing the matching of the donor recipient in the issue of hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, and HIV serological data. Here you can compare the matching of the donor with the recipient. Here, for example, in hepatitis C, donor positive to recipient negative, it is decreased from 0.8% to 0.4% in the current transplantation. Regarding hepatitis C positivity in the donor, this is a very interesting point, and it creates a dilemma and a headache in transplantation. Our policy is to consider HCV positive donors as a relative contraindication for donation. And we usually discuss this issue in a special case by case, and we don't accept to donate a kidney from HCV positive PCR to HCV negative recipient at all. But sometimes the problem of positive antibody and negative PCR, can we accept? Generally, we don't accept, but we can accept in certain cases, like mother giving a kidney for the kid, and after repeating PCR, and it was confirmed to be negative. Regarding this issue, the issue of the hepatitis C serology was discussed within the American Society of Transplantation Consensus Conference on the use of hepatitis C. Here, this is the best terminology. As I read this article of this conference in details, because they don't like the term of positive serology of hepatitis C virus, but they would like to look at the nucleic acid testing. And if nucleic acid testing is positive, this is the HCV viremic patient or donor. But if HCV PCR is negative, nucleic acid testing is negative, and merely positive antibodies, this is non-viremic. So donors with positive hepatitis C antibody, but without viremia, haven't been documented to transmit hepatitis C virus. This is the core message of this consensus. Thus, historical outcomes data of HCV positive donors must be viewed as limited, since it doesn't specifically differentiate the presence or absence of viremia by nucleic acid testing. The term hepatitis C viremic donor include nucleic acid testing result does differentiate the presence of viremia from its absence, follow allowing for improved communication regarding infection transmission risk. The term hepatitis C virus viremic donor should be adopted to replace the term of HCV positive donor. Again, all these experts are experts in the field, mainly in the field of cadaveric. And this is a very interesting table. If we have here antibody positive, PCR positive, this active infection, and the transmission is likely If antibody is positive and nucleic acid is negative, no active infection, either cleared or treated, prior infection or false positive antibody, and there is no documented transmissions. Here the antibody is negative and nucleic acid is positive. This may be acute infection in the antibody window period or false positive nucleic acid testing, and here we should be cautious because the likelihood of transmission. If negative, negative, no HCV infection and no transmission. So all these data are very interesting based upon the issue of evolution for diagnosis of the hepatitis C virus. In the short period after infection, this eclipse period, you will find no evidence of nucleic acid testing or antibody. So the everything is here is absent. But after a while, nucleic acid test becomes positive, and then after weeks, the antibody starts to appear. So all through the period of testing, the nucleic acid test is positive, and so we should look at the nucleic acid test. So if you have antibody, you should have nucleic acid testing based upon this consensus meeting. Again, it's better to look individually and to respect the risk. Usually we discuss this issue, and I have my experience during the 10 years ago when I considered the antibody a positive PCR repeated negative as false positive antibody testing, and we have at least 10 cases like this of donated kidney from antibody positive nucleic acid test negative to recipients, with some of them had negative HCV, and the results was we don't have any case documenting recurrence, documenting transmission of infection from antibody positive PCR negative. But as I mentioned, we currently we restrict our acceptance for special cases like mother giving their recipients, and be sure that the nucleic acid is repeatedly negative. So all these issues are very important regarding the use of direct antiviral drug, because it allows the dealing with HCV with because in the past we cannot give interferon for hepatitis C after kidney transplantation because of the fear of precipitating rejection, but in the presence of direct antiviral drugs we can treat safely patients after transplantation. This is a nice experience. In 31 cases were treated after transplantation by direct antiviral drug. Here both graft and patient survival at most recent follow-up was 100%. There was no significant change in the glomerular filtration rate before or after therapy by direct antiviral drugs. And the interesting data, this is the regimen used, sofosbuvir, lidi, bezver, and this is the regimen used and the ribavirin dose used for the different patients and different genotypes. And this is the status of proteinuria, because you may have had patients with proteinuria, a total of 6 cases considering 19% of the patients, of the 31 patients, had worsening proteinuria during or shortly after therapy by diet and antiviral drugs. Patient was more than 500 milligram per gram proteinuria, milligram protein per gram creatinine at the start of treatment, were significantly more likely to develop worsening proteinuria than those with less than 500 milligram protein per gram creatinine at the start of therapy. This preliminary data demonstrate that direct antiviral drugs can be used safely and effectively in patients after kidney transplantations. Patients with proteinuria or lower GFR should be monitored more closely. Again, I present this issue within the immune suppression, low-dose rituximab 200 milligram in kidney transplant patients without antiviral prophylaxis is associated with low incidence of hepatitis B reactivation. However, the use of 500 milligram may increase the activation of the virus. So rituximab used for the sensitization for incompatible kidney transplantation significantly increased the risk of hepatitis B virus reactivation in hepatitis B S antigen negative, anti-hepatitis score positive, therefore close monitoring for this patient is required if rituximab is used. The second virus that I wanted to discuss is the BK virus. It's the human polymavirus, and it's a member of Babovirid family, which include JC and SV40. This double-stranded DNA virus has 80% seroprevalence in the general population. Infection likely occurs through the respiratory tract during childhood, establishing latent infection in the urothelial cells of the urinary system. Following kidney transplantation, viral shedding occurs in 30% of recipients, with 10% of those developing BK nephropathy. Renal allograft failure occurs 50 to 80% of recipients developing BK nephropathy within 24 months of viral detection. Risk of viral reactivation is highest within the first year following transplantation when immunosuppression drugs are high. And this is the steps. This figure illustrates the possible surgery of BK virus, known to BK nephropathy. BK is reactivated and replicated in the distal tubular cell, as you see here. This is the normal kidney, and this is the reactivation if the host receive immune suppression within the so BK cause cell necrosis and the initiate of local H damage and inflammation. Here, this is the local damage and the inflammation, and the denudation of the basement membrane result in here in the leads to infection of the intertubular space and subsequent peritoneal capillaries. The result in viruria. Continued virus spread leads to a cycle of cytokine release, inflammation and cell damage, resulting in viremia and nephropathy. Recurrent cell damage can eventually lead to fibrosis. So this is actually the cycle, and this is the different protocols for management, the mechanism of action, immune suppression withdrawal, recipient immune system to clear, allowing the immune system to clear the virus, and the adverse effect of this scenario is development of acute rejection. So the efficacy is 74% within 9 months. Here you can find cidofovir, leflunomide, quinolones, immunoglobulin, T-cell immunotherapy, and you can see here this, all these are not strong evidence treatment for BK virus, and seem that reduction of immune suppression is the core of the management and the careful monitoring to diagnose the development of rejection. How to predict? This is a very nice study because it addressed the immunology. Pre-transplant immune factors may be associated with BK volume of virus activation in kidney transplant recipients. And this is based on the immune, the issue of immune senescence, pre-transplant low CD4, CD8, and increased effect of CD8 became viremic. So we can predict, and this is the issue in pre-transplantation, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and 12 months. And here you can look at CD4 T cell types, and this is, this color denotes the effector, this color the effector memory, central memory and naive, and you can look here to know where we are. And this is for CD8 cells. So the we can study CD4 and CD8, and we can predict the occurrence of the BK virus after transplantation based on this analysis. And you can find here the odds ratio for the all these issues. Let us go to the immune suppression, and this is a very nice study because it's a systematic review and meta-analysis of 28 randomized controlled studies, including 6,000 patients. They found moderate to high quality evidence of reduced risk of cytomegalovirus virus in renal transplant recipients in the mTOR inhibitor based compared with calcineurin inhibitor based regimen. Why? Because mTOR inhibitors may disrupt the proliferation of virus because they are anti-proliferative for the virus as well. So the this review also suggested that combination of mTOR inhibitors and the reduced dose of calcineurin inhibitor may be associated with similar estimated GFR and rates of acute rejection and serious adverse events compared with the standard similar estimated GFR rates of acute rejection and the adverse effects compared with standard calcium inhibitor based regimen at the expense of higher incidence of proteinuria and wound healing complication. And this is the core results. If you look here, this is the 4CMV here. Definitely, the use of mTOR inhibitors was associated with lower CMV, but insignificant effect on the BK virus. Here, with looking at the comparison of mTOR inhibitor versus calcium inhibitors, but use of mTOR inhibitors plus reduced dose calcium inhibitor versus a reduced regular dose of calcium inhibitor plus mycophenolic acid and other sovereign here, the same issue. The BK is significantly lower, CMV is significantly lower, and the BK is insignificantly affected by this immune suppression. So again and again, the use of mTOR inhibitor reduce the CMV. So all these data should be put in mind, because it is very important to be known that mTOR inhibitor is associated with reduction of CMV virus. Regarding latent TB in transplant candidate, how to manage 12-week rifabentin plus isoniazide or 9-month isoniazide for the treatment of latent TB in renal transplant candidates. This is a retrospective data evaluating the issue of management of latent TB in renal transplant candidate with latent TB. The patient is either treated with 12-week rifabentin plus INH or 9-month daily INH from March 1, 2012. Renal transplant candidates were given the option to choose between weekly rifabentin 900 milligram if weighing more than 50 kilogram and an INH 15 milligram per kg, maximum 900 milligram for 12 week, or daily INH 5 milligram per kg, maximum 300 per day for 9 months. Patients from both groups were asked to take daily pyridoxine 50 to 100 milligram to prevent INH isoniazide related neurotoxicity. The patient reasons for choosing or declining the 12 week rifabentin INH options were recorded. On a 9 months regimen was offered when the use of rifabentin wasn't recommended. Like these are the indication of 9 months treatment with the patient is under treatment of with clopidogrel or warfarin. The patient has uncontrolled hypertension because rifabentin will increase the metabolism of antihypertensive drug and worsen the hypertension. Is too confusing for the patient. Sulfonylurea treatment, lack of health insurance, beta blocker treatment for congestive heart failure or antiarrhythmic treatment, treatment for HIV or hepatitis C, chemotherapy, calcium inhibitor treatment. All these can be affected by rifabentin. So this is an indication for 9 months INH. So 12-week rifabentin plus INH appears to be an excellent choice for latent TB, unless there is compelling indication for the use of INH for 9 months. Please don't forget to use pyridoxine to guard against the neurotoxicity. And this table summarizes the adverse reactions in this study. Regarding another type of infection, Clostridium difficile infection in solid organ transplant recipient, this is one of the most important and interesting reviews, because Clostridium difficile is a common diagnosis in solid organ transplantation, with up to 30% of this population affected by the Clostridium difficile infection, and estimated incidence varies with the type of organ transplant, lowest in kidney recipients, 3.5 to 16%, and the highest in lung recipients. This is a very interesting point. In lung recipient, between 7 to 31%. And in this review, the core message is judicious use of antibiotics in solid organ transplant is the mainstay of Clostridium difficile infection prevention. And this is to compare Clostridium difficile infection in non-transplant versus transplant patient regarding the risk factors. This is the risk factors. anti-micro exposure, same as non-transplant, prolonged hospital stay, here use of anti-thymocyanoglobulin, advanced age, use other immunosuppressant drugs, uremia, gastrointestinal surgery, possibly gastric bypass. Here, all these are the issues of transplantation. Clinical spectrum in immune-competent persons, it is self-limiting disease, may be severe. Increased risk progression to severe disease, increased risk of severe dehydration, increased toxicity of medication, organ rejection, all these are witnessed in transplantation. This is the difference of Clostridium difficile infection in transplant patient compared to non-transplant. Diagnosis, assay detects toxin producing genes and the toxin production, same as the non-transplant, rule out other cause of diarrhea. The treatment, metronidazole, vancomycin, oral, and other drugs is the same. Antibiotic stewardship program, this is a very important point to prevent. We should establish the antibiotic program in the hospital to guard against Clostridium difficile infection in the general hospital and in transplant patients. Another study addressing the Clostridium difficile infection, where the 52 cases of Clostridium difficile were identified in 42 kidney transplant recipients. This corresponds to an average annual of 9.6 per 10,000, higher than seen among general hospital inpatients. Education regarding Clostridium difficile must be extended to transplant recipients and their general practitioner. This is of crucial and stringent antimicrobial stewardship, both in hospital and community. And judicious use of PPIs, proton pump inhibitors, because the use of proton pump inhibitors may increase the risk of a Clostridium difficile infection. This is how to diagnose, step one and step two. You can fix and look at the data. Regarding the vitamin D, this is a very interesting study correlating the vitamin D level and the infections. So here we can diagnose the status of vitamin D, either sufficiency, insufficiency, vitamin D deficiency, vitamin D severe deficiency, here if the level is in this range according to the KDIGO guidelines. So vitamin sufficient, if the level of vitamin D is above 30 nanogram per ml, insufficient if it is between 15 to 30, deficient if it is between 5 to 15, and if it is less than 5 nanogram per ml, it is severe vitamin deficiency. And if you look here, the any type of infection is reduced, the odds ratio is 0.3, and the confidence interval is between 0.23 to 0.52, and the p-value is highly significant. This means that vitamin D protects against infection. And this may be explained by the action of vitamin D in immunity, and because vitamin D inhibits Th17 related immune responses, suppresses this issue. And this cartoon shows how vitamin D reaches its site and manipulates the immune cells. This is a very nice review and to be considered. This is a very nice, interesting data showing the immunological mechanisms or the pleiotropic effect of vitamin D, metabolic effect, reduced diabetes, reduced lipid level, cardiovascular effects, decreasing cardiomyocyte proliferation, increasing here antineoplastic by these mechanisms, decreasing angiogenesis, decreased cell proliferation, and anti-infective, so it reduces the infection by increasing bactericidal and biochemical mediator. Again, this is a very nice slide showing the correlation of vitamin D with different parameters of chronic allograft dysfunction. So this is a great review of chronic allograft dysfunction, calcium inhibitor, recurrence of ordo nouveau, hypertension, vascular damage, urological problems, infections, metabolic parameters, IFTA, chronic antibody and T-cell mediated rejection. Here, what is the value of vitamin D? All dark squares, vitamin D counteracts. So vitamin D is friend for the vascular axis because it reduces hypertension, it reduces infection, so it combats infection, it improves the metabolic derangement, reduces fibrosis, reduces antibody mediated rejection. So all these are fantastic actions of vitamin D. Regarding malignancy, What is the importance of malignancy? We should know very well the history of the patient, because the presence of a pre-transplant cancer is bad news. Because in our practice and in all transplant practice, we wait for a period of duration ranging from 2 years to 5 years for clearance and be sure that there is nothing for the, and the tumor is cured completely. However, even after 5 years, the presence of previous history of pre-transplant cancer is a risk for increasing either recurrent cancer or de novo cancer within the transplantation. And you can find here the issues of recurrent and de novo tumors in this population. Again, the presence of pre-transplant cancer increases the incidence of cumulative cancer after transplantation and increases death too. This is why we should be interested in the issue of cancer screening in transplantation. However, we need a consensus based on evidence-based medicine how to tackle the issue of malignancy. However, we should put it in our mind, should good, have a good history, and we may think of manipulating the immune suppressive drugs in a patient with this history, and to be careful in early detection of any clues for malignancy. BTLD, as you find here, this is a correlation with the Epstein-Barr virus. As I mentioned in the everolimus, the data is not encouraging to use everolimus with negative Epstein-Barr virus serology, because it will increase post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorders, as you see here. And if the Epstein-Barr virus is negative, this is the issue, and this is the situation with positive serology for Epstein-Barr virus. And as I mentioned, in the sector of immune suppression, usually in adults, there is positive for the serology is positive for Epstein-Barr virus, but for children, you may find a good proportion of negative Epstein-Barr virus. We should be cautious about the use of everolimus in these scenarios. Persistent Epstein-Barr virus and the cancer, another story, risk for post-transplant cancer. Here, the all patient had Epstein-Barr virus PCR testing at least once a year. A positive testing was repeated on each routine visit. The periodicity of visit doesn't depend on Epstein-Barr virus PCR result. Persistent positive viremia was defined as being unchanged or increased viral load over 6 month period. A decrease in immune suppressive was performed in patients with Epstein-Barr virus PCR greater than 10 to the power of 4 on 2 consecutive separate measurements. Mycophenolate mofetil was first tapered and eventually withdrawn. In PCR remained above 10 to the power of 4 log Epstein-Barr PCR. This study clearly highlighted an association between persistent high Epstein-Barr virus load and the occurrence of solid cancer. This result suggests that Epstein-Barr virus monitoring should be considered in all transplant patients. More intensive screening and or minimization of immune suppression treatments are probably required in this patient's population. So you can see here, if there is high viremia detected by PCR, the risk of the cumulative cancer incidence increased significantly in comparison to here, 11 or 9%. Here it is 19 and 26%. And these are the cancer related to the persistent Epstein-Barr virus. This is survival probability. If the Epstein-Barr virus viral load is high, persistent here, it adversely affects the survival. Again, the interesting data, the interaction between the poliomavirus and smoking, both of them increase the risk of cancer bladder. And this is the cancer. The finding of this study indicated that kidney transplant recipient with poliomavirus replication and smoking are at particular risk to develop bladder cancer carcinoma, and supports the need for long-term cancer surveillance in these patients. Okay, we should look of the poliomavirus and smoking as well, because in comparison to the cocktail of smoking and the polyomavirus is significantly associated with increasing risk of cancer bladder. And this is how the BK led to oncogenesis by increasing the oncogenesis cycle, as you see here. An infection with BK virus can lead to a productive infection, resulting in cell death or cell lysis due to release of mature daughter virion from infected host cells and or latent infection, resulting in cell survival without apparent viral replication. Other mechanisms lead to sporadic viral integration into the human genome through unknown mechanisms. Once integrated, the virus is no longer replication competent and cannot produce daughter virions. Integration with linearization result in decoupling of lead promoter mediated feedback, and at the end you can find the oncogenesis as present in this figure. A very interesting data about the thyroid cancer. This is a cohort of 229,000 patients, and here the risk of cancer thyroid following transplantation is 2.5-fold higher in transplant recipient than in general population. And if we look, the kidney transplant had the highest risk of thyroid cancer. Thyroid cancer histology, papillary carcinoma is the most common type, and the local diagnosis. And so the thyroid cancer stage and diagnosis, the majority is local. And here the association of thyroid cancer with duration on dialysis. So the longer the duration on dialysis before transplantation, the higher the risk of thyroid cancer after transplantation. And this is the correlation with medication. And you can see the difference here in the according to the drug used in the cancer thyroid. As this is a case, a 60-year-old gentleman underwent live-related renal transplantation from his wife on 2010 for indecision and disease, second with diabetes and hypertension. He was maintained on triple immunosuppression drugs, including tacrolimus, prednisone, and the mycophenolate of TEL, and had nadir of creatinine of 1.1. And in May 2010, he developed a TCL mediated rejection and was managed with ATG. In September 2015, he presented with generalized weakness, fatigue, and weight loss for 6 months. The patient had severe pallor and mild hepatomegaly, hemoglobin of 5.6, microcytic hypochromic anemia. So the patient here, this is a renal transplant recipient presenting with non-specific constitutional symptoms and the facial suggestive of gastrointestinal bleeding. So and this was the PET scan. Fluorodeoxyglucose beta scan. You can find hot areas here in the colon and in the liver, and as you see in the colon and even in the graft here. So the primary you can find the diagnosis here of PTLD, you may think of PTLD, but the key message here, if you find occult edema, you should think of cancer, other sources for cancer. And here the colonoscope and the biopsy revealed the carcinoma of the colon. So this is a very important point to address the investigation for clarifying the etiology of malignancy to properly select the anti-tumor. Recurrent treatment of cancer, we have a FDA-approved category of drugs known as checkpoint inhibitors. At easy points, if you look here, the tumor cell present BD program, this ligand 1, that bind with BD1 molecule. So when it binds to BD1 molecule, it inhibits the lymphocytes. Inhibiting lymphocytes leading to spread of malignancy. So to combat this issue, because stimulation of BD1 leads to cell wasting and exhaustion. However, if we block this PD-1 by antibodies, which is used here, like anti-PD-1 antibodies, it will stimulate lymphocyte to combat malignancy. So the main mechanism of this drug. Another also checkpoints here, these molecules, if we use anti-CTLA-4, will inhibit this binding, and this will lead to stimulation of lymphocytes. So the currently available checkpoints inhibitors are the FDA approved either ipilimumab, which is IgG1 human CTLA-4, this is for melanomas, and another drug which is bimbrolizumab and nivolumab, which are PD-1 inhibitors. So they are antibodies for PD-1, and here this is the list for other drugs. And but be careful, because the use of checkpoint inhibitors, especially nivolumab, you can find increasing inflammation and increasing interstitial nephritis, electrolyte disturbance, etc. And this is the difference. And this is a very nice case documenting the issue of antibody, because anti-PD-1, programmed cell death 1 antibodies have demonstrated anti-cancer activities and survival benefit, but due to their mechanism of action have been associated with auto and alloimmune adverse events. Alloimmune like rejection, antibody-mediated rejection, etc. And here the author reported a case of a kidney transplant patient who presented with autoimmune hemolytic anemia and severe acute graft rejection after administration of nivolumab. A 73-year-old man was diagnosed 15 months post-transplant with superficial spreading melanoma as a metastatic stage. Immune suppression was reduced and tacrolimus switched to everolimus. After two injections of 3 mg per kilogram per body weight of anti-PD-1 antibody at 30-day interval, the patient presented with acute renal failure 25 days after the last dose, with an enlarged kidney transplant and grade 2A acute cellular rejection on biopsy. No donor-specific antibodies were identified. The rejection was resistant to high-dose steroid, and the patient returned to dialysis. Simultaneously, he developed autoimmune hemolytic anemia with a COMS assay positive for complement and severe thrombocytopenia. There was no evidence of thrombotic microangiopathy, no platelet antibodies, and no local invasion on bone marrow histology. It resolved in 1 week, associated with use of high dose steroid and cessation of nivolumab. The patient died from dissemination of melanoma. There have been 7 other reports of anti-PD-1 administration in kidney transplant patients, 6 nivolumab and 1 bimbrolizumab. Among the total 8 patients, 6 presents with acute cellular rejection, BANF grade 2A or 2B, including 2 patients with areas of cortical necrosis. No patient had donor-specific antibodies, and the timing of rejection a few days or weeks after nivolumab suggests causality, especially in patients on stable immune suppression for 10 years or more. In home, reduction of immune suppression wouldn't be expected to result in immediate rejection. Anti-PD-1 antibodies have also been associated with autoimmune manifestation, with autoimmune hemolytic anemia reported in 4 cases. It occurred after a mean of 4 cycle, was COMS positive for IgG and or C3, and responded well to high dose corticosteroid. This case, as reported in this article, is the first description of autoimmune hemolytic anemia in a transplant patient. The indication of anti-PD-1 therapy will likely increase in the transplant patients with cancer. The transplant community must therefore be aware of the risk of allograft rejection and transplant loss. Immune suppression minimization, while the recommended approach to active neoplasia and transplant recipient, must be reconsidered when the patient is treated with anti-PD-1 therapy, because anti-PD-1 therapy will stimulate immunity. Regarding diabetes and bone, this is the percentage of diabetes after 1 year, 3 years, and 5 years, according to this data. And here I want to stress upon the effect of diabetes on the patient survival. So distance or graft survival doesn't differ between diabetes and no diabetes. And regarding the important update is the correlation of hemoglobin A1C, although hemoglobin A1C is not accurate in dialysis patient, but higher pre-transplant hemoglobin A1C above 5.4, as shown in this report, is independently associated with greater risk of post-transplant diabetes among kidney transplant recipients because a continuous relationship between pre-transplant A1C and risk of diabetes after transplantation suggested that increased risk starts at A1C here below the current threshold for pre-diabetes. So if it is above 5.4, this increases the post-transplant diabetes, as I mentioned. In Sudan, this is a nice report showing the five patients out of 58 developed diabetes, and so the percentage of diabetes is 8.6, and the prevalence of new diabetes after transplantation in the Sudanese is less than 10%, and there was no association between new onset diabetes after transplant and age, sex, and the positive mass index. However, there was a significant association with family history, so we should respect the family history of diabetes and other factors as well. Regarding proton pump inhibitors in general, we recommend this prescription of proton pump inhibitor because many physicians abuse their use. So they are essential drugs when they are indicated for treating acute ulcer or other indication like Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. But we should avoid the prolonged use and the higher dose of these drugs because it may lead to graft dysfunction, lead to infections like Clostridium difficile infection, as I mentioned before in this presentation. Here, increasing risk of hip fracture after kidney transplantation. To check of the bone mineral density is not enough. We should look at the trabecular microarchitecture as well as microindentation. This is the osteoprobe that help in the microindentation technicality. Regarding CKD MBD, this is the summary, executive summary of 2017 KDIGO guidelines. You'll find sector for transplantation. Here you can read in patients in the immediate post kidney transplant period, the recommendations is to measure serum calcium phosphate at least weekly until stable. In patient after the immediate post-transplant period, it is reasonable to base the frequency of monitoring serum calcium phosphate and PTH on the presence and the magnitude of abnormalities. Here, the recommendation afterward, you can fix and read all these regarding the profile of CKD-MBD after kidney transplantation in different stages of CKDT, looking at calcium, phosphorus, and the PTH, and how to manage. All these are discussed within the sectors of recommendation within the executive summary of the 2017 KDIGO CKD-MBD. A very interesting study discussing the issue of post-transplant hypophosphatemia. What's your expectation? Is hypophosphatemia is good or bad? In this issue, the authors unexpectedly showed the better survival for patients who had hypophosphatemia, and they categorized patient into severe hypophosphatemia if serum phosphate is less than 1.5, mild hypophosphatemia between 1.55 and 2.17, or absent if the serum phosphate above 2.17. So here you can find the correlation. If there is a hypophosphatemia here, you can find cardiovascular mortality and graft failure is significantly reduced in the patients with hypophosphatemia, but here the non-cardiovascular disease doesn't differ in significant difference. So the presence of hypophosphatemia may translate good graft function. Another interesting point is metabolic acidosis. We don't like metabolic acidosis in chronic kidney disease. Here in transplantation, in a cohort, retrospective cohort study including 2,000 patients, 2,300 cases, metabolic acidosis is indicated by low serum total CO2 concentration, and it is a risk for mortality and progressive renal dysfunction in this transplantation. So we should think of metabolic parameter like metabolic acidosis, and you can see here increasing complication if the total CO2 is less than 22. Regarding urology, here just a few slides about the risk factors from urology perspectives. This is the issue of preoperative antibiotic prophylaxis to prevent surgical site infection in solid organ transplantation. It's a very nice article. And here, this is the domain of the solid organ transplantation in the kidney. The incidence of surgical site infection ranges from 3 to 11%. The predominant pathogens includes Staph aureus and enterococci, and secondary pathogens including gram-negative organism and candida species. Risk factor categories, this is the host-related factor, diabetes, obesity, chronic glomerulonephritis, reoperation, surgical factor, urethral leak, hematoma, blood transfusion, donor graft function, delayed graft function, contamination, acute graft rejection, immunosuppressive-related medication, azathioprine, ATG, MMF, and mTOR inhibitors. And this is the how to manage, even giving the antibiotic for 24 hours. So this is the, you can read in details. Another interesting point is the how to predict the occurrence of wound, surgical wound complication within the kidney transplantation. The mid-abdominal circumference that was measured in all potential transplant in this study on the morning of their kidney transplant, and it was measured in the horizontal plane midway between lowest rib and the iliac crest to the nearest 0.1 centimeter at the end of the normal expiration. Increased mid-abdominal circumference is a significant predictor for surgical wound complication, as you see here in this table. Again and again, lymphocele. So the despite preventive methods, lymphocele frequently form following kidney transplantation, with an incidence ranges from 0.6% to 51%. Here, this is a summary of risk factors from the donor-related factor, capsule injury, lymph vessel injury, recipient-related factors like old age, high body mass index, comorbidities, perioperative therapies, immunosuppressive like sirolimus, high diuretic dose, heparin, high corticosteroid, the early patient mobilization, acute cellular rejection. All these are risk factors that should be addressed. And the satisfactory algorithm is to start the first line, then second line, then third line. The first line is external drainage, and if it requires sclerotherapy, using doxycycline, and if it requires fenestration of the peritoneum. Here, this is a nice study, a meta-analysis showing the prophylaxis of lymphocele formation after kidney transplantation via peritoneal fenestration, a systematic review. And this study shows that the meta-analysis of included trials showed a significant reduction of clinically symptomatic lymphocele and overall post-operative fluid collections without a significant increase in other surgical complication. Although peritoneal fenestration is a promising technique to reduce lymphocele formation, only few studies have investigated this technique so far. Given the low methodological quality of included trials, more studies are necessary to evaluate the effectiveness and the risk and the benefits of this technique. But as you see here, it is effective, but the data needs further studies. Regarding vesicoureteric reflux, this study of 1,008 adult renal transplant recipients, 1 week after transplantation, avoiding cystic restrogram was carried out, and the incidence of reflux was 9.5%. And they concluded that post-transplant vesicoureteric reflux has no correlation with early bacteriuria, renal function, and graft survival. There were no follow-up voiding cystic restrogram available. Unknown is whether reflux could disappear naturally after a few weeks when the surgical site is completely healed, or whether reflux actually can arise later on. Earlier findings show that vesicoureteric reflux may change with time after surgery. So this is the data of this study. To stent or not to stent, I think this is left for the surgical opinion. And in this study, they observed no risk factor for routine double J stenting placement in pediatric renal transplant procedures. And a stent is usually removed by 6 weeks. And I think it is left for the surgery. This is a very nice case showing a recurrent UTI. And with this lesion on cystoscope, after transplantation and after removal of this lesion. And this is the pathology showing the lesion. This is Michaelis Gutmann bodies reflecting melanoplakia that reflects the effective phagocytosis of the bacteria, and the patient is treated by removal of this lesion surgically and the prolonged use of antibiotics. Here, this is a very nice study documenting the that embolization for the syndrome of graft intolerance is equipotent and effective, like open graft nephrectomy. And I know that graft nephrectomy is difficult surgery. However, we're still not convinced by embolization, because embolization may create inflammation and headache. But the data here include here this arm of the embolization includes 32 patients compared to 40 patients, and it seems that worked well. This is the end of this presentation, and I should end by the same slides of H sector. Live as if you were to die tomorrow, learn as if you were to live forever, and again and again and again, we need to read and we need to practice medicine, because I am a great believer in William Osler's statement, he who studies medicine without books sails an uncharted sea, but he who studies medicine without patients doesn't go to sea at all. I am very happy that I reached my destination for this workshop that included 5 talks about the renal transplant update. I started the first presentation by introduction, the second one including the update in transplant immunology, and the third one the update in immune suppression, and the fourth one was the pathology, and this was the complication. And I know that I never cover everything in this tutorial, but I did my best just to highlight the most recent published articles within the last few months. Thank you very much, and I'll be happy to receive your questions through my emails. Goodbye, and thank you.